We are the fag end of this two-day long seminar. I have been here since yesterday. Now, my job has been made easy by Mohanty sir and Mishra sir by delving on the topics of refund. I would like to just highlight some practical issues which we are dealing with when we are dealing with refund situations. Now, first issue which we have undergone is kind of the supplies to SEZs. Now, for supplies to SEZs, it can be a supply of goods or a supply of service. It can be supplied, the goods or services can be supplied either under a bond or under LUT. And consequently, the supplier can claim a refund of the input taxes over there. Again, if there is a supply to a SEZ unit of the services, one of the conditions in Rule 89 says that there has to be an evidence that the services have been used by the SEZ for the authorized operations, and it has to be endorsed by the competent authority of the SEZ. Now, this is quite similar to the provision what it was there in the erstwhile service tax regime, wherein there was a concept of Form A1 and A2. Now, we do not have that kind of a format in GST, and therefore, assessees feel that this could be a possible, when they go for refund, this could be a possible issue that how they can evidence that the services have been used for authorized operations of the SEZ. I would request Mohanty sir to share his thoughts on this, maybe after I finish. Because this is a practical issue. We had a mechanism in the past. We don't have that mechanism now of Form A1 A2. And therefore, the transition is something which should not block the credits of the suppliers to SEZs. The second issue, which is also a transition issue for that matter, is for 100% service exporters or 100% exporters. Then maybe some credits which were there in the books which could not be claimed as refund in the pre-GST regime, but those credits have been transitioned in GST. But according to the, now if he's a 100% service exporter, the CGST law does not allow to claim credit or the refund of the pre-GST credit which has been transitioned under the present GST Act and rules. Now, here, this is a result of blocked credits for that kind of a service exporter, right? So this is, now there could be a genuine reason for that exporter of not having claimed that credit in the past. So he has an issue of blocked credits where he's unable to claim that credit as a refund in GST because of a particular provision in the CGST Act and rules. Third issue, which is actually a practical issue, an operational issue, if I may say so. Mohanty sir also mentioned that there is a timeline of 2 years from the relevant date of filing a refund claim. Now, imagine a situation. Now, service exporters have been used to filing quarterly refund claims in the past. Now, many service providers also have a quarterly system of billing. And especially the outsourcing units, they have a quarterly system of billing. In those situations, if there is an quarterly system of billing, but the refund has to be claimed for a month, the system allows us to claim a refund for a relevant period, which is a relevant tax period, which is a month. And consequently, what happens? If you do not have export turnover in a particular month, which is to be derived in terms of the CGST rules, then the system does not allow me to claim credit or rather refund of the previous month's credit, which is there in the system. Because I may issue an invoice in the month of December, but I may realize in the month of January. Therefore, my export turnover gets recorded in the month of January. But what happens to the credits which are there for the month of December? The system at present does not allow me to do that. Whereas in the previous regime, we could claim a credit of refund of that. So this is an actual operational issue which I believe has already been brought out to the notice of the government, and therefore there needs to be a resolution of this because this has resulted in a blockage of funds for some of the export service providers. One more issue, which is again a practical issue over here, is when we talk about the deemed exports. Now, Mohanty sir also mentioned that that's a very beneficial provision where supplies which are deemed exports, like a supply to a EOU or supply against the advance authorization, supply against the EPCG hold, to a EPCG holder, those are all going to qualify as deemed exports. And here, the supplier and the recipient, either of them can claim a refund of the tax. But a very distinguishing feature between a zero-rated supply and a deemed export is, in case of a zero-rated supply, you can supply the goods without without charging GST under LUT or a bond, whereas in the case of a deemed export, you have to necessarily charge a GST. And thereafter, either the supplier claims a refund of that or the recipient claims a refund of that. This is a departure from the concept of zero-rated supply. Now, the practical issue over here is, there is a condition in the notification says, which says that if the supplier is claiming a refund of the GST paid on the deemed export, then he has to take an undertaking from the recipient or the customer that he is not going to claim a refund of the taxes charged. Now, commercially speaking, the customers are reluctant to give that kind of a undertaking. They are saying, I am not going to claim a refund of this. You are going to claim a refund. My document says so. Why do you require this kind of an undertaking from me again? So this is again, there has been some thought process for protecting revenue in this case, but this has resulted in a practical situations for the suppliers who want to claim a credit, but on the want of that document, if the customer is a big company and he has got a dominating position vis-a-vis the supplier, then he says, I don't want to issue this certificate to you. Therefore, these are some teething issues and transition issues which need to be taken care of when we talk about refunds. We have seen there is a timeline issue as well. But with this, I would like to, these are some experiences which we have faced in our day-to-day operations. And with that, I thank you for your time. Hope you have enjoyed this today's session. Thank you.